Hey, hey. Good morning. Do you guys hear anything when they say good morning? Did anybody hear anything? Good morning? Hey, there you are. It's nice to see you. Happy Sunday. Why don't we stand and let's just worship right now. Is that cool? We planned accordingly.
My fortune lies beyond the stars. A thousand heights too vast to climb. I got so high to fall so far, but I found heaven as love swept low. My heart beating, my soul breathing. I found my life when I laid it down. Upward falling, spirit soaring, I touch the sky when my knees hit the ground. A treasure waits within your scars.
He will lift. He will lift the anxious and the weary, calling home the burden.
Let's just lean into that a little bit and think about like why it is that we would show up in this like X warehouse box store because there's a miracle, like, right? And that miracle is, if you've trusted Jesus, that miracle is in you. That story is in you, and it's true. It's truer than anything that's ever happened. It's truer than the most, what you think is the most true of you. It's truer than that. It's more real than that. It's more real than what's going on in your body physically or your finances or your family. And my guess, it's more, a little more than a guess, is that a lot of us need like a work of God, a miracle. A miracle. You're thinking, well, I don't need a miracle, but I need some help. Well, all right, you're in the club. So why don't we just hold ourselves before the Lord, and maybe it's somebody around you that you'd like to intercede for, but you need the power of heaven roaring within you. And remember the, like, I think it's the first verse, or is it in the chorus where it says, I see a miracle in an empty grave, right? That, you know, you realize, right, like, the reason we meet on Sundays, the reason the early Jewish followers of Jesus moved their main meeting day was because of that miracle. That's like this, the center of everything. And so the Bible says, the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead, if that spirit dwells within you, then he who raised Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal body through his spirit who indwells you. So right now, why don't you do this? Why don't you close your eyes? Why don't you, if you're comfortable doing this, why don't you lift your hands? And why don't you just say something like this, a power of heaven roar within me. It's just, and whatever miracle you need, whatever work of God you need and you'd like, just go ahead and ask him for that and speak that right now. You don't have to say it loud, but you can just whisper it in your life. And there's probably, sometimes like the whole church will pray for something or someone. There's probably somebody that you wish, like, man, I wish the whole church would pray for them. Well, I'm going to speak for everybody here. We're willing to pray for them. Can I get an amen on that? So if you just speak their name right now, everybody, I promise you, everybody around you will hold them up and agree with you in prayer. Like, I'm going to start it off. Tom, prostate cancer. So go ahead, just speak names around you, and everybody around you will agree. Dennis, back. So Lord, we thank you that the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us. And the same Jesus that rose from the dead has authorized us to speak in his name, to ask things in his name, and has promised to act on our behalf. And so we pray all these things in great faith. And all God's people said, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amy's gonna tell you what's going on. Yeah, go ahead and clap a little bit. So this is my friend Amy, and where is she? Oh, there you are. And she's gonna tell you what's going on around Journey now. So why don't you give a little clap for Amy, is that all right? All right, just a little.
Actually, if you haven't sat down yet, get back up and go find two people. Sorry, I'm making you do stuff and bossing you around already. Go and find two people you haven't met. Say hi, introduce yourself. Hey, good morning, Journey. My name's Amy, and welcome. We are so glad that you're here today. Whether this is your first time here, or your like 31st time here, or 431st time here, we just want you to know you are always welcome here. No matter what you came in these doors carrying, you are welcome here. If you're full of doubt or full of faith, you are welcome here. We are so glad that you're here, and we hope that this place can be a refuge for you and a sanctuary for you to figure out your life with God in good company. So welcome. We are so happy you chose to spend this morning with us, or some part of this morning with us. And if you are new, I just wanted to extend a special welcome to you and encourage you on your way out to hit those wooden tables out there, the welcome tables. There are some of the warmest, friendliest, hilarious people out there who are dying to meet you. They are offering a free gift, so they're bribing you to come be their friends. And also, they just are really passionate about helping people feel connected and feel like this is kind of like more a small church because there's a lot of people here, but we want this place to feel like home. And so that's what they do there. That's their specialty. And so go say hi to them if you can on your way out if you're new or haven't gotten connected yet. And with that, on that thought of like having a small church feel, we're doing something new this summer. Starting on July 19th, we're going to be having 3 consecutive parties here, right out here on the plaza. We're going to have a huge cookout. We're calling it Summer Nights. And it's going to be such a fun time. There's going to be music. There's going to be food, like galore. We want this to be a multi-generational event. So everybody's invited, from great grandma all the way down to the babies. There's something for teens. There's something for everybody. Will have games, like think four corner or red light, green light. It's going to be tons of shenanigans. Chris and Morgan are in charge, so you can expect a lot of shenanigans. It's going to be a blast. And so we would love for you to come and make friends and laugh and just enjoy the summer with us out here on the plaza. You don't even need to RSVP, but we have free kid care, so if it helps you to be able to make friends without chasing your kids, you can put your kids in kid care and just scan this QR code. A lot of us with younger kids are already architecting our summer. And so find a way to Tetris this Summer Nights into your summer calendar because you don't want to miss it. And sign up your kids so that we have plenty of hands to hold your kids, love on them, entertain them while we have a great time doing Summer Nights out here. And something else on those Summer Nights is we're going to have like a 15-minute, like think TED Talk, right? It's going to be like a spiritual injection in the arm, some awesome topic. And all the topics are like a teaser for some of the classes that are ahead this fall. So it might give you some inspiration about what you might want to explore with God this fall. So join us for Summer Nights. It's going to be a blast. And if you have been here for any length of time, you know that we're not just about building our church community and like staying in our holy huddle. We care about being out there. We care about what's happening in our backyard. We care about what's happening in East County and in the nations. And one of the things we take seriously is the last words of Jesus. He said, go and make disciples in all nations. And so because of that, we're trying to send out. And so we have a few trips happening this year. One of them, if you were out in the lobby on your way in, you probably saw the Dominican Republic fundraiser. Our college group is going to Dominican Republic, which is awesome. So they're buy some goodies on your way out because that's going to help fund them and put some money in their bank. But we're going to Zambia. But what I want to invite you to today is in October, we're going to take a team down to El Salvador, and we're putting together that team right now. We need about 5 more people to be able to make the team happen. And what we're going to do, don't worry if you don't speak Spanish. Don't freak out, because actually it helps that you speak English, because there's a youth center down there that one of our old pastors started, and it's for at-risk teens, and they teach English there, right? So hooray, you speak English. And also, we're going to get to share the good news about Jesus in public schools, which is completely different there. It's not illegal there, so you're not going to go to jail, but it's going to be a really faith-building time. And so if anything that I'm saying like sparks a chord inside of you and stirs something up inside of you, I want to invite you to please scan this QR code. It'll take you to a website. I did it on Friday. It literally took me 12 seconds to fill out my information, and you're not signing up for the trip. You're just saying, I just want a little more information, and we'll get you the information and pray about it and see if this could be something that you could do. A lot of times we think these trips are for like spiritual superstars or like Bible gurus, and not at all. This is for anybody who calls Jesus Lord and thinks, I want to share the love of God with the world. And so try this out. We would love to have you join us in El Salvador for the team for El Salvador. And then as far as like locally, we care about what's happening in our backyard. And one of the things that's on our hearts every year around this time is teachers, right? If you are scrolling in the news feed for any length of time, you'll read articles about teacher burnout and like a mass exodus of teachers leaving the profession. It's a big deal right now. And even before the last 3 years of like chaos and upheaval, teachers, it's been a regular occurrence that teachers have been taking money out of their own pockets to buy their own school supplies for their students. If you're in a Title I or an under-resourced school, it's more, right? I have a friend who's a high school teacher in a Title I school, and she was regularly buying shoes for her students because they didn't fit. She bought like hotel rooms for kids that were homeless until social services got involved. It's a calling, and we want to come alongside of teachers in this calling, and so we want to invite you to do that. We, every August at the top of the year, we adopt 4 schools. 3 of them are Title I schools here in East County, and we come and we bonanza them with school supplies. We throw a party, and they can literally shop for free and get all the school supplies they need for their classroom. We can't solve the other stuff, but we can say, this we can do, right? We can do this. So I want to invite you to scan this QR code, pick like two things on the list. And while you're at Grossmont Center, grab them, come in the middle of the week or next week on Sunday and throw them in the bins. We'll have a bunch of bins outside to collect the school supplies. We want this to be a mountain of school supplies. We've done this for 12 years running, and it's always a gift to our community. And we want them to know we stand for them and ultimately that God stands for them. So let's do this together. This is an amazing opportunity for us to love on our neighbors. So thank you in advance for giving. And by the way, we'll collect all month, but try to pretend like we're only collecting until next week so we really get ahead, okay? So on that vein of giving, I want to invite the ushers forward to give the tithes and offerings. And if you're new here, please feel like no pressure to participate and just be our guest and let the bag pass on by. There's no judgment. But this is for those of us who call ourselves Christ followers. This is our way of saying yes to God and putting him first in our finances. And for those of us who have been doing this for a while, the tithing and the offering, you can ask many of us, like ask someone you know, like there is so much financial freedom and blessing that comes from taking this step of obedience. So if you're giving today, thank you so much for partnering with us, and also may a generous God meet you this week. So thank you. And while the bags are passing around, let's get ready for the message. We are in a series called Jesus Revolution, and it's loosely based on the recent movie that came out about 4 months ago about the hippie Jesus freak movement, which is a lot of our roots come from that. And so hopefully you got one of these programs on your way in. It'll help you follow along in the message. Or you can download the Journey Community Church app. That'll help you follow along. But Ed will be up to give the message right after this video. Check it out.
Hey, Square.
I am not a square. I
think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
They need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about. Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching.
Slow down, man, slow down.
Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help.
If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah. Man, thanks for coming. Glad you're here and hope you're having a good weekend. Yeah? Good weekend? Good weekend? You know, like, we don't have time to celebrate everyone's birthday. You know, like, hey, would you stand up? Like, but if you're a friend of mine and you're 91, then we're going to make an exception, don't you think? So Joe, would you stand up and let us clap for you? Come on. Yeah. Yeah. All right. And him and Noreen and his family, they're still serving God and making an impact, and they love the Lord. He's awesome, and I'm proud to call him a friend. So as you saw from the little video there, we're doing this series on this movie, or like really not on the movie, but inspired by the movie, Jesus Revolution. And if you haven't seen it yet, then go see it. Like, you know, as soon as this is over, you can get it on Prime. You can buy a Blu-ray disc. It's really easy. And if you're going, Ed, I just can't afford the $3.95 to rent the movie. It's like, I'll pay your movie. All right, just come up to me. I'll give you $4, and you can just go watch the movie. And I trust me, it's a beautiful movie. It's really well done. Even if, aside from the message, it's a good movie. And it's not like a message movie, like a movie that's a sermon put to movie. It's really awesome. So I hope you see it. The true story of a national spiritual awakening in the early 70s and its origins within a community of teenage hippies in Southern California. Many of you don't know what that word means. We'll help you out with that. But like I said, this isn't God at the movies per se, but it's a movie and we're finding God. So I don't know. It's not that. But I do want to show you a couple of clips, one or two per week. And so this is the first one when we talk about, like, this just will set you up a little bit. So check this out.
Protest U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War in mass marches, rallies, and demonstrations.
Now, Eddie Bellbottoms, reporting live from San Francisco, the self-proclaimed hippie capital of the world, where hundreds of thousands of youths have descended to join this growing youth movement. The words peace and love are used by them often. These kids call themselves hippies and represent a new form of rebellion against the status quo and the so-called materialism of their parents. Their message to the world, turn on, tune in, and drop out.
I just want to celebrate, yeah, yeah, another day of living. Yeah, I just want to celebrate another day of life. Had my hand on a dollar bill, and the dollar bill blew away. But the sun is shining.
Be back later, Mom.
The hippies present a social dilemma. The clothes they wear, the way they preach love as opposed to hate, peace as opposed to war. These beliefs set them up as rebels against a materialistic, square, old-fashioned society.
Everywhere, young people were turning on, dropping out. The hippies, pot, speed, acid, alcohol seemed to take a back seat.
You guys stare at that thing like the world is ending.
I think the world is ending.
Well, I think what they're doing is kind of beautiful.
Honey, are you doing drugs?
No, Mom, I'm not doing drugs. Please stop asking. Look, what I'm saying is that they want peace and love. Isn't that the same thing you want?
I think these kids need help.
What they need is a bath. I don't know if they can be helped.
See, and there's the problem. You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about. You've never even met a hippie.
I thought they didn't talk to squares. Didn't you say I'm square?
Then you are the very definition of a square.
I'll tell you what, when God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
Where are you going?
To do drugs.
So... It's a really cool story, and in many ways, actually in a fairly direct way, this is, if you've walked in here this morning kind of new, this is our story. Like, the church that was the locus of this is our grandfather church, right? And so that's kind of cool. But the deal is, the reason I felt led for us to do this, and the rest of our team was like, yeah, I think we should, is because it's the story, the Jesus Revolution is about a move of God, a wave of the Spirit. And what I'm asking you to do and what I'm doing and what a lot of us starting last week started doing is go ahead, put that slide up there. We're asking God for another one of those, right? We're asking God for another move of the Spirit, another wave of the Spirit. And you know, the cool thing, I mean, the encouraging thing is that God likes to do new stuff. You know, there's several places in the Bible where God says, I will do a new thing. Like, he likes to do new stuff. There is a great, you know, if you believe the Bible, there is a great move, a great thing that God's going to do that is coming, that's been prophesied and predicted, a huge wave of the Spirit that's like, this is about 4 centuries before Jesus. The prophet Haggai said this, yet, this is God speaking through him, for thus says the Lord of hosts, Yahweh Sabaoth, once more in a little while, I am going to shake the heavens and the earth. What does that sound like? The first verse of the Bible, right? The Hashemayim Va'aretz. Like, I am going to shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. It about covers it, don't you think? There's a shaking coming. There's a move that God is going to do that's going to shake stuff. And it seems to me, at least, that we need a good shaking in our world right now, in our country, in our, you know, in the planet, in our schools, in our homes. In me, I could use a good shaking. I don't really, it's kind of scary, but I think I need it, right? We need another Jesus revolution. And so what we're, like last week, kind of what we did at the end of the message is ask you if during the 4 weeks of this series, so we're 1 week in, if you would commit yourself to pray every day, asking God to send a wave of the Spirit, like a big wave of the Spirit on our land, on San Diego, on our state, California. Are you in?
Yes.
Yeah, all right, so good. So here's, what would it look like? What would another Jesus revolution look like? What did this one look like? That's kind of the thing I was interested in, is like, what was this? I grew up right around there, and I wasn't a church guy at the time, but I got a little, you know, like after the next wave, after the big one came through. But the deal is, like last week we talked about how really there were several revolutions, and the most obvious one is the one we talked about last week, and that's the open doors revolution. Like kind of the simplest thing, and it seems, and by the way, things always seem obvious several decades later that weren't obvious at the time. So it's easy to kind of be a historical moment snob and to look back on people and go, well, I don't see how they could ever have done that. It's like, if you were there, you'd have had just as hard a time seeing it as they did. But there was this, the first revolution, and the one that this kind of drives the movie is this revolution that says, just come in. And like, you know, back then it was somehow cool to not wear shoes. I was a part of that. I don't know what we were thinking, but whatever, right? It's like the whole world was Michael Fronte. And there's this, and that was us, right? But they said, you know, just come in. But this next, there's another revolution that took place that you might have missed, or it's not as at least easy to see in the movie, but it, trust me, it very much is a part of this revolution, and it's very much it very much was driving it, and it's, I'm going to call it a Bible revolution. There was an open doors revolution, and then part of this in the Jesus revolution was a Bible revolution. And I'm going to show you one more clip, and I want you to see something that will take us into the passage of the Bible we're going to look at today. So watch this.
Chuck, there's more of them. What are you going
to
do?
I don't know. Until yesterday. I guess I'm just going to have to ask them to leave.
Sounds great.
Wow. That's
so great. Life's great.
You guys.
Excuse me. Who are you?
Hi, Chuck. That's Ron. This is Mickey. That's Lynette at the table.
Hey, Ron.
New brothers and sisters. Hope it's okay. They stay here too.
Isn't it great, Dad?
No, it's not.
Oh. And I'm Connie.
Yes, my wife Connie.
You're married.
Wow, you're a real pastor, huh? That's a trip. We're gonna have some questions for you, mister.
Maybe later.
Yeah. Are they camping in my yard?
Oh, it's okay. Don't worry about them. They're used to it. They don't mind.
All right.
Wait till you see who's here.
What have you done to my home? What are these people doing here?
Met them at a coffee shop in Newport.
Hey, man. Nice house.
What are they doing in my house?
Because I have this idea. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them into my church, I'm gonna lose my job.
Just listen, huh? Sit here. Hey, guys, can we just give them a taste, huh?
In my weakness, you always make me strong. All I wanna do now is praise you all day long. Since I opened up the door, I can't think of anything else but you anymore. Since I opened up the door.
Cool. By the way, Kelsey Grammer is a boss in this movie, and he's such a great actor. When you can portray something without saying a word, right? Oh, it's so good. Anyways, back to the message. So here's the weird dilemma of the movie, and again, from many years later, you go, well, why was this hard? It just was. Because it's a human thing. This is what waves of the Spirit do and deal with in people. See, one of the stories in the movie, kind of one of the themes flowing through it, is about a church defending their faith by actually not doing what their faith calls them to do. Like holding on to stuff, saying this must be preserved, and in doing so, like missing the point of it all. Jesus called this at one point, he says, you strain out the gnat and you swallow the camel. Like, you know, back in those days, clean water was a huge deal, like it is in many parts of the world today. And so they'd use a strainer to get all the bugs out of their water. And so Jesus' thing is kind of funny, you know, you're straining out the gnats, and in the meanwhile, swallowing the camels. And this is, and the reason you know this isn't a new thing, or the reason you know this isn't a past thing. Like, if we were to say, yeah, those people were so dumb, thank God we're not like that anymore. It's like, oof, you know, like, you know, this isn't a them thing. This is a human thing, right? And one of the reasons we know that is that's one of the main themes of the Gospels in the New Testament is this thing. So here's the story we're going to look at today from the life of Jesus. It's in Mark 7. It'll be on the screen. You can look it up on your phone. Most of it's on your outline, but we're going to start before where the part in your outline starts. Chapter 7, it says this, the Pharisees and some of the scribes gathered around Jesus and when they had come from Jerusalem. So by this time, Jesus is very popular. He's got huge crowds everywhere. So like, and he's had several, like part of, if you were map, like trying to follow the story of Jesus, one way to do it would be to get a map of Israel out and just see north, south. Because all Jewish people at the time were making these regular pilgrimages to Jerusalem for the feasts and stuff. And Jesus had been doing that. We know that he's been doing that since he was a kid. It's in, in Luke 2. So like, Jesus had come to Jerusalem, kind of made a stir, lots of people, you know, there's quite a buzz. And so some guys from headquarters need to come and check this out. That's what's happening here. They're up from Jerusalem going, all right, you hillbillies in Galilee, you really don't know what you're talking about. We want to make sure this guy isn't too much of a problem. They'd come up from Jerusalem and had seen that some of his disciples were eating their bread with impure hands, that is, unwashed. And then now Mark's going to give an explanatory comment because Mark's a local. He's from right there. He says, and a lot of people, he knew a lot of people that would read Mark were not local and would not get this. It says, for the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they carefully wash their hands. That phrase in the language is written in, they carefully wash their hands means they wash to the fist, to the wrist. So there was this way you were supposed to wash. Now you realize, right, this is pre-germs, pre-antibiotics and all that. So it wasn't about, you know, stuff on your hands. It was about ritual cleanness. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they cleanse themselves. So if they go out to buy stuff, they definitely cleanse themselves. And there are many other things which they received in order to observe, such as the washing of cups and pitchers and copper pots. That word washing there is the word baptizing. Unless they, and it doesn't, it just baptize, the word means to dunk something or to immerse something. And so like there was a ritual about how you wash your dishes and all this stuff. And so like, and in fact, even like we inherited this from the Jewish roots of our faith from, you know, our Messiah is Jewish. You're aware of that, right? Like the guy, that Jesus guy and all 12, every book of the Bible is written by one of them. But there was like, when you go to Israel, I say when, I hope you all go someday. But there's, whenever they dig up like stuff from ancient cities and villages and stuff like that, There's always, and they're all over Jerusalem, they always find these things called, it looks like a, like kind of like they had jacuzzis back in those days. They're, you know, they're yay deep, and they have two sets of stairs like separated. There's one you go in and one you come out, and it's like an in-ground swimming pool, and they're called mikvahs, right? And you can, mikvah is a thing, it's a noun, and it's also a verb, you know, like a, you take a mikvah, as it were. And it was about cleansing and about purity. And so like this was a thing in Judaism. This was a thing in the first century, and it still is today. And then, so here's the part that's on your outline. They're like, why do you guys do this? Why do you not wash your hands like properly? Why do you not follow the tradition of the elders? And he said to them, rightly, or Isaiah said this beautifully, is what it actually says. His prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. And in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the precepts of men. Neglecting the command of God, you hold to the tradition of men. And he was saying, he was also saying to them, you are experts. Remember I said in Isaiah, when he said, rightly did Isaiah say, he actually said, Isaiah said this beautifully. And he goes, here's what you do beautifully. It's the same phrase. He's kind of having a parallel here. And he's saying to them, you guys, you beautifully set aside the commandments of God in order to keep the tradition. For Moses said, honor your father and mother. And he who speaks evil of his father or mother is to be put to death. Honor your father and mother. Where have you heard that before? I'll give you a hint. It's in the last words, commandments. It's a number right after 9, right before 11. All right, yeah, good. The 10 commandments, right? Or the Esharet Devarim, as it's called in Hebrew, the 10 words of the covenant. Like, so like, this is not something that's in some obscure part of Leviticus. You know what I mean? Like the part right after you, after the offering, you drag the hide of the cow out and bury him. This is in the parts that back then and right now are the most famous part, right? The Ten Commandments. It's pretty obvious. And one of those is honor your father and mother. The other quotation that he gives, if he speaks his father and mother, that's later on in the Torah. It says basically not honoring or dishonoring or you know abusing your parents, it was a capital offense. You could drag your kid out and say, this kid's being a jerk and he's rebellious, and they're going, all right, we'll take care of that. It's like, and there, now how much it actually happened, I don't know, but that was the, at least the law, right? If they say, or he says, but you say, if a man says to his father or mother, whatever I would have given to help you is korban, that is to say, given to God, well, you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother. Thus, invalidating, if you're taking notes, circle that word, invalidating the word of God by your tradition, which you have handed down, and you do many things such as this. That word invalidate, it means to cancel, to nullify, listen to this, to render powerless. You render powerless the word of God. Boy, that takes some doing, right? To render powerless the word of God. You keep what God says. You keep it at a safe distance. I'm saying this is not a them thing. This is not a first century thing. This is not a 1969 thing, back when regular middle class people could afford to live in Newport Beach and you could just park your trailer on the beach like Rockford Files and this guy. Like, right? It's like, dude, I live in that trailer, right? Wouldn't you? You're like, all right, you right now, I'll trade. So anyways, that's whatever, sorry. But this is a us thing. Like, we like, there's scary stuff in the Bible. There's stuff that we're going, yeesh, that's kind of extreme, Jesus. Don't you think it's a little extreme? I mean, I gotta go to work. I got a job. I got friends. I, you know, like Starbucks. I don't want to be a weirdo. I mean, there's stuff that scares us. And so the Bible is meant, like, part of the point of the Bible is to mess with you, is to mess with us, is to mess with our church, is to mess, just to mess with you. That's one of the reasons God gave us the scripture. That's one of the, and I mean, Jesus is the living word. And did he not mess with people? Like, on the regular, he seemed to go out of his way. Look at this passage right here. He goes out of his way to make it as just uncomfortable as possible. He didn't say, I know you guys mean well. He says, you hypocrites. It's like, whoa, wait. Right out of the box, he's like, whoa, I'm messing with you. And there's at least three areas for all times, in all churches, for all people, for you, for me, that the Bible wants to mess with you. And the first is the Bible versus our tradition. The Bible versus our tradition. See, let me see if I can explain what's happening to here. See, here's what was going on. So there was a word from God, part of the Torah, in this case, one of the Ten Commandments. So there is the Devar Elohim, the word of God, right? So there's that. Now, let's get off this example and we'll do a different one. Another one that came up all the time in the life of Jesus, and that's like the last of the commandments, or not the last, but towards the end in the second tablet, it said this, you shall remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Does that ring true? All right. Just by the by, that's the only one of the Ten Commandments that's not repeated in the New Testament. It's the only one that if you're, you know, a Gentile, it's not, I'm not saying it's not a good idea. It's just not the commandment for you. But for the people of Israel, it very much was. So here's the commandment. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. And it also was clear in the word that meant we're not gonna work on the Sabbath, right? Yes, you've heard this before, yep, no? Yeah, all right, so that's the story. But then you go, and you can understand, this is easy to understand. Well, what do you mean work on the Sabbath? All right, I'm not going to my job, but can I do yard work? Because that kind of relaxes me. Can I cook dinner for my family? Can I take a walk? If so, and that question was, by this time, there was actually a distance of how far you could walk. Like, it's like they had early Fitbits, and they're like going, okay, all right, you can go 4,570 steps, all right? Now you gotta come home, because you gotta stay under 10,000 for the day. And that was called, there was this the oral tradition, when they say, how come you don't follow the teaching of the elders? That was called, that's if you ever talk to your Jewish friends, that's a mission, that's the Mishnah. The Mishnah is the collection of the oral tradition of when they said, okay, all right, you can't work. So here's what this means. Can we turn the lights on? No. So you light the candles the night before, or you'd like leave the lights on all night long, because like, and even in modern times, electricity is considered making a spark. And so you're kind of creating fire, as it were. And we don't do that. God rested. We don't create on a Sabbath day. And if you go to Israel today, the hotel we like to stay in Jerusalem is about 15, 16 floors up, I think. And there's on Shabbat, there's a regular elevator and a Sabbath elevator. And on the Sabbath one, you don't push buttons, because that would be breaking the Sabbath. The elevator just comes up, you get on it, right? And then it just stops, whether you want it to or not, on every floor. And you're like, well, what's wrong? It's annoying, but it's not bad, right? So there's that. And then there's like, well, what about, okay, can we get together as a family on Sabbath? All right, you can if you're only this distance away. And you can, or can we like eat together? Well, you gotta cook the food the night before, so make sure it's something that's gonna be okay, you know? And then, but you're not supposed to carry anything on the Sabbath. So how do we do that? Around, this is a fun little factoid. Around the entirety of Manhattan and Brooklyn, there is, and I didn't know about this till I heard a story on it. There is this thing called the Eruv. The Eruv is on pole to pole to pole, there's this fishing line like wire stuff. And the wire goes around the whole city, because the Mishnah says, here's the deal. You can't carry something from my house to your house. But if our houses are connected, constructed-wise, then you can carry stuff from like, if it's part of your house. So the Eruv says, like, okay, we're all one big house, and you can now carry your stuff around and walk around freely within the Eruv, right? Now, none of that stuff is, like, necessarily toxic. But here's, and the Mishnah, by the way, if you ever wondered, it got collected with the Gemara into this thing called the Talmud. But anyways, but in this case, the tradition was about this word korban. Korban, there's a slide coming up of that. See, that's what it looks like in Hebrew, and then it's pronounced korban or korban. And korban meant something connected as a gift for God and close to ordinary humans, human use. So it's like this. The word korban is in Leviticus 2, verse 2, and verse 4, and a bunch of other places. And that's where it comes from. And the word means an offering. It's an offering. So what they were doing is this. You're like, in this culture, you were very much obligated to take care of your parents, like until they die, right? That was a solemn duty of kids. They had a great culture going back there. But but people then and now are like, oh, this is burdensome. You know, and I want to just live my life, right? So like you buy like an 80-inch flat screen and it's awesome. And all of a sudden your parents need something. And you're like, oh, I guess I could sell the flat screen or the new board I bought or a new car or whatever. And so what they would do is call the flat screen korban. Lord, this is your flat screen, right? Here it is, Lord, it's yours. And as I watch it, I'll remember that it's yours, right? And so when your parents needed help, you would say, oh, this is so... Just on your way over here, I dedicated this to the Lord. I didn't know what you were going to come over to ask. So I'm sorry. Yeah, but what about your car? Yeah, korban, you know? It's all korbaned up. See, what's ironic, I think, that in this moment of history in 1968, there in 69, 70, 71, and like those that period of time, the churches, you see how empty that church was, the little scene of the, there were lots of churches in that situation, lots and lots. People were like, especially younger people were going, ah, I'm not into this. And they were kind of, because the church was identified with a culture that they're like, I don't dig that. I'm not there with that. And so like some churches, a big chunk of churches said, yeah, you know what the problem is? The problem is the message. We gotta make this more palatable to all these people out here, all these people that no longer wanna go to church. So they watered down the message to say, hey, as long as you're a good person, you know, you might not be a Christian, but the spirit of Christianity is in you, like that, right? And then part of this revolution is instead of watering down, they doubled down on the message. They said, yeah, you're without Jesus, you have no hope. Like one of, like back then, I remember one of the first verses that was laid on me when I became a Christ follower in 1975 was John 14:6. It felt like every Christ follower in the world was running around saying, I am the way, Jesus, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. Weird, right? And so like even today, it's kind of this, we're on the internet, maybe I shouldn't say this, but it's like if you go to a church that's very, a Protestant church, this is different with our Catholic brothers. If you go to a church that's very traditional today, it's very much, it's a much higher likelihood that they're not into the Bible as much. Right? I'm not, please don't hear me going, yeah, they suck and stuff. I'm not saying, right? Don't hear, don't run out of here going, yeah, it said if you have robes on the pastor, then that's a sign you're, you know, apostate. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying it's a weird irony that the more traditional the form, the more likely it is to be, to have, I shouldn't have said that. Scrub that. We're gonna put the 11 o'clock service up there. I just found that as a fascinating thing. We'll be relocating our church next week, so pay attention to the internet to find out where to find us. I really didn't mean to cause trouble. So the other thing the Bible will confront is our culture. The Bible confronts every culture in different areas all the time. It's there in every culture, there is stuff that's toxic. Now, here's how the toxic stuff in a culture goes. You can see this in our culture today. There's some things that everybody, the followers of Jesus and those that aren't, people in church and people that aren't, there's some things that everybody agrees, this is toxic. This is bad. We have this in our culture, but we don't want this in our culture. But then there's other things. There's three levels of things that we disagree on, like there's a controversy within the culture. And then there's other things that the culture at large decides, not only is this okay, it's virtuous, it's good. And if you're not down with it, then you're not good. And the Christ followers are like, and God is saying to us through the scripture, nah, we're not gonna be doing that. No, we can't sign off on that. In the first century, you know, one of the things as the Christians were being martyred in the arenas and stuff, one of the things that the crowd would shout was this, death to the atheists. We're like, what? Put the lion back. I'm not an atheist. It's like, we won't do Zeus and we won't do the emperor. Then there's, you know what else? It's the Bible versus me. The Bible versus tradition and culture and me. That should be on the screen there. There you go. All right. The Bible versus me. It's not just it. It's me. The Bible calls me out, like me and you. Like it calls you out on all your BS and all the nonsense and silliness in your own life, right? And here's the deal. All waves of the Spirit call us back to the vintage thing that it was supposed to be. That's what Jesus, Jesus was really clear. He says, I'm not coming here to overturn the law. I'm not here to overturn the Hebrew Bible and the Old Testament. I'm here to tell you what it really means. This, because we always tend to drift from the original thing. It always happens. We always go from movement to institution. That's just a thing that humans do. And also, like, it's always relational. Like, it's a movement of God doesn't just call you back to it. It calls you back to him. Jesus said about the scriptures, he said, you know, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, but they are the ones that testify about me, and you're unwilling to come to me so you may have life. Hear this really clearly. The Bible never saved anyone, and it won't save you. But the Bible, done right, the Bible will lead you to Jesus. And when you're connected with Jesus, he will lead you back to the Bible. Because how do we know anything about Jesus? See, the Bible versus traditions, the Bible versus culture, the Bible versus me. And so here's the question of the morning and the question of the weekend. And I'm gonna have Nolan come up and help me explain this to you. I gave Nolan like just a huge amount of advance notice, called him on Friday morning and said, hey, can we have a sculpture for this weekend? And this is what he came up with. And dang, right? Right? All right, there. I know, you all know that I'm a great artist, but world class. But Nolan's got his strengths too. But so this, we wanted it to kind of sort of look Jesus-ish, right? I think it's pretty good, right? Jesus? Yeah, okay. Now, we are going to get rid of this afterwards, so we're not like making an idol out of this thing, so it's okay, right? But like, so this, in your, like, there's a sense where we go, yeah, I got you, Jesus. I got you. I'm one of the good guys. You know, I'm into the Bible. I'm one of the good guys. And I like Jesus. But like, sometimes, like, let's give Jesus, what are we doing? Just the mustache? Let's give him a unibrow like Anthony Davis. There you go. So, all right. You're like, I like my Jesus with more of a kind of a serious eyebrow look right there, right? So, yeah, you know, he's a Middle Eastern guy. Maybe that's what he is. And some of them are like, you know, one of the things that bugged me about all the Jesus is they have perfect teeth, you know? And maybe Jesus didn't have perfect teeth, you know? So maybe he looked a little more like that, you know? So, I don't know. And maybe Jesus had a little Wyatt Earp in him, you know, with a handlebar mustache. You know, I think that would look kind of cool if my Jesus had that, don't you think? You like that? Some of you are going, I'm a little uncomfortable right now. It's like, yeah, there it is. See, here's one thing I've learned. Whenever somebody says to me, you know, I just can't see Jesus, and then the next sentence out of their mouth is going to be unbiblical. I just promise you. See, here's the question. This is the whole message right here. The question is this. Am I going to mold the Bible, or is the Bible going to mold me? Am I going to mold the Bible, or is the Bible going to mold me? See, that's the question. It's kind of like, you know, like if you on Kook Slams, this Instagram account, there's a disproportionate number of knuckleheads on jet skis, and then there's also people behind boats on those inner tube things, right? And you're holding on, and sometimes it's a bit of a wild ride, right? Like if you've ever like tried, you know what I'm talking about, right? You rent a boat, or you have a boat, and you put those big tubes behind there, and it's like, can be kind of a wild ride. And sometimes letting the Bible mold me is kind of a wild ride. You're like, wait, I was wrong about this. Oh, this isn't what it looks like at all. Hey, this makes me uncomfortable. And am I gonna let the Bible mold me, or am I gonna try to mold it? So here's what you do. You do this. You meet God every day in his word. So as part of your spiritual practice, you just decide, I'm going to meet God. Notice how I'm saying that. I did not say read the Bible every day, although clearly that's implied, right? Remember, the point of the Bible is to bring you to Jesus. The point is not so you would know the Bible. I want you to know the Bible. But that's not, if you stop there, you end up like these guys or like the guys in the movie or like us sometimes that are more shaped by our tradition or our culture or our own thoughts than by God's thoughts. And over time, here's the point of meeting God in the Bible is you become a friend of God. You become his friend. Psalm 25, it says, the secrets of the Lord are for those who fear him. You become a person to whom God tells his secrets. And let's do this also. Let's stay on. Let's build our life on, stand on, and also make sure we live our life under the Word of God, starting with the living Word of God, Jesus. And then, huge, don't miss the point. The cool thing, one of the many cool things about the scriptures is there's numerous places in there where it tells you, all right, this is the point. You don't have to guess, what's the point of this? There's places it tells you. Here's one in John chapter 20. He says this, these things have been written. So here's the point, right? You're getting it right now. These things have been written so you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Look at it. Look at the screens. Why were these things written for us? So that we would trust Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God. What happens if we do that? That when we, in trusting him, we have life in his name. We have life in his name. That's where life is. The Bible was given to you so that you could have life in Jesus. So let's stand and we're gonna worship, but first I wanna give a chance for those of you that have never received Jesus into your life to do so right now. Why would you not want life? I know it's weird, you might go, dude, I'm alive or I wouldn't be here. Well, yeah, sort of, but there's a part of you that is not and needs to be resurrected. Right now, you were born, sure, but there's a birth from heaven that God offers you where you'll really feel alive. And that comes by trusting Jesus. So if you, why don't you bow your head and we're gonna pray. And if you need to pray this prayer, I want you to pray it right now and invite Jesus into your life and you'll see right away. And then over time, you'll really see that you have life now. So here's, you could try praying this. Dear God, thank you that you love me. And thank you that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for me. And that because of that, everything I've ever done and everything that's been done to me can be taken away. Jesus, come into my life right now. Save me. Make me the person you want me to be. For the rest of us, like, we've made a commitment, right? That we're going to pray every day. I hope for more than 4 weeks, but for at least the next 4 weeks, we're going to say, God, send another wave of the Spirit over our land, over our church, over our state, over our nation. God, send another wave of the Spirit, a movement of God. So here's, use this first song as a way to pray that prayer. Like, together, we're gonna pray and say, God, send a move of God. Let's worship. Sorry, man. Yeah, I got a little carried away there. So you couldn't have missed the communion tables. Some traditions you got to do, right? They're right in the Bible. So sorry about that. This was going so smoothly up till then. So, yeah, this is definitely going to be an 11 o'clock on the YouTube. So, so while we're doing this song, grab the communion elements, the cup and the bread, and then in between songs, we'll take communion together. Anytime during this song, you can just make your way to one of the tables. So, thanks, Kathy.
Break spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Lord, send revival. Lord, send it now. The move of your spirit, heaven break out. Come now in power, cover this land like you've done it before.
Do you believe that? You know, the promise in the word of the Lord, again in Haggai, shortly, remember that verse I shared early on about shaking the heavens and the earth? You're like, dude, that was a long time ago. I don't remember that. But right after that, it says, the earth will be filled, will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the water covers the sea. It's gonna happen. It's gonna happen because this happened. The victory happened. So the body of Christ broken for us, take it now in remembrance of him. Jesus took the cup on that Passover night and said, this is the new covenant in my blood, given for the remission of your sins. So you can be free of sin, free of brokenness, nothing between you and God. So let's take this in remembrance of his shed blood. Yea, God, thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. So let's worship him with one more. Yeah, I think we should clap, yeah. All right.
Hold me now.
Cries out. as always, if you need prayer, our amazing prayer team meets over on this side of the room. They'd love to partner with you and pray with you. We love you guys. Have a happy Sunday, and we'll see you next weekend. Be blessed.